And before I say too much, I'd like to introduce Brian. Brian O'Rourke, our moderator, is a health sub-industry expert, a technologist, a financier, a shareholder, and an executive in several fitness companies. Brian's expertise has led to a track record of results in fitness and wellness, food and beverage, international trade, technology, and franchising. He's led organizations and projects in Asia, the EU, and the Americas, and has transformed organizations and brought stakeholders together in a variety of roles. And Brian has served as a court-appointed expert and advises public and private for-profits and nonprofits, NGOs, and government agencies. He has successfully closed a number of private and public financings and managed M&A activity as a principal, agent, or advisor. And he is, and his articles have been published in a variety of established periodicals. So he'll take it from here, introduce the panel, and thank you, Brian.
Hey, thank you. Great. Welcome, everyone. First off, as you've denoted, we're going to talk about the quantified self. And before we begin, I want to congratulate the organizers of this event. I don't know who had the contacts with the man upstairs on the weather, but it's been completely awesome. That's you. What a beautiful place and what a wonderful setting. I'm privileged to have the chance to introduce our four esteemed panelists, many of which you already know. First, Paul. Paul Dorotich is, of course, a high-performance advisor at Own the Podium, where he provides leadership, mentorship, and advice to Canadian Olympic winter sports with respect to performance analysis and technology. He coordinates research projects with Canadian sports centers and universities. He has a master's in biomechanics from the University of Saskatchewan and has conducted 3D kinetic analysis at the University of Calgary. He is a leading thinker and expert on technology application in sport. And thank you, Paul, for being here and welcome. John Bruner, for those of you who saw his talk yesterday, it was a great talk. He is a program chair of O'Reilly Solid and director of O'Reilly IoT and Hardware, where he's focused on the intersection between software and the physical world. The Solid Conference, of course, which he co-chairs, brings together engineers, artists, executives, researchers, and entrepreneurs to explore the ways that virtual and physical are merging. They have a variety of resources, including books and videos related to this. In his prior life, of course, outside of this, interestingly, John served in a variety of roles at Forbes, where he contributed in research, new product development, was data editor. I really enjoyed, again, his talk yesterday. Thanks for being here, John. Haley, who just got off the stage with her talk. Welcome, Haley. She's a PhD student, School of Informatics and Computing at Indiana University, working in the Pro Health Group. Her research focuses on the potential role of technology in the lives of people with rare diseases. She has a master's in human-computer interaction with a health emphasis from Indiana University and a bachelor's in commerce with a minor in computer science from the University of Calgary in Alberta. She's the institutional voice chair of the Graduate Informatics Students Association. Her group recent paper, Muscle Memory, Identifying the Scope of Wearable Technology in High-Intensity Exercise Communities, received a Best Paper nomination at Pervasive Health 2015. Welcome and thanks, Haley, for participating. And we saved the best for last. Raymaker needs no introduction. He was recently featured in Runner World magazine as one of the 50 most influential people in running. And that noted him as being extremely socially media savvy and an expert in a variety of areas. He's well known to the Garmin and Ant community, of course. His blog, DC Rainmaker, reviews technology use and use for runners, cyclists, triathletes. He started that 8 years ago. And recently, in February, web traffic chart of ad-supported bike websites, DC Rainmaker was listed 6th in terms of North American traffic and overall traffic by Bicycle Retailer Industry News, which described DC Rainmaker as the paper of record for bicycling technology and highlighted his strong ethical independence. Of course, Ray lives in Paris, and I enjoy following your post on Twitter, Ray. Thanks for being here, man. So, without further ado, our theme today is on data and the quantified self, and we're going to ask our panelists some questions, have a little debate about them, exchange some ideas. We talked before and we said no throwing of chairs, lighting of anything on fire, or screaming and use of profanity unless it's absolutely necessary. Ray thought that it would really help the YouTube posts if we did that. He is social media savvy, after all. So anyway, panelists, we often talk about the athlete and how tracking their data is important for them to determine their performance outcome. And technology has certainly changed the way athletes train. But what about the everyday person? What about the mainstream? How does tracking our data determine their personal outcomes? How can we learn from this data, and what are the advantages to capturing your own personal data? Is your data the honest story of you? So, Paul, let's kick it off with you. Is this data we're talking about a true measure of the self in regards to athletic ability and health? What do you think?
Tough question, but I think unequivocally I could say it depends. It really depends on the qualities of the devices and the intent to which you're going to put those measures. And so I know in this room there are a vast number of engineers and designers, so this won't come to you as a surprise when I talk about the qualities, but for those who don't have that background, it's maybe worth getting on the same track in terms of the language. So in high performance sport, I'll often think about reliability, precision, accuracy, and validity of the measures that we're trying to achieve, and how does that then reflect on what we're trying to do with the athletes. So being a sports scientist, I always use sport analogies. So if you think of the sport of archery, do we have any archers in here at all? Okay, good, so it'll all be new. So if you imagine any of us trying to pick up a bow and trying to shoot at a target, we'll be lucky if we even hit the target. And if we do, you know, one shot will be up here, another over here, over here, over here. It's not a very precise activity at this point for us. But you put that same bow in the hands of the Korean world champion, and they'll cluster those shots into a very, very tight group, and that's precision. If you think about the reliability, then, is if that athlete comes back the next day, same conditions, no changes in the environment, can they put those arrows back in exactly the same spot? That's the reliability. So if you think about wearable technologies, you might think about heart rate monitors. And a heart rate monitor that's on a strap on the chest, very tight connection to the body, very reliable. If you go to the optic sensors on your wrist, if you get into a very active form of exercise where there's a lot of movement, you lose some of that contact, the reliability starts to become a bit of an issue. If we then take a look at that archer once more, and maybe that Korean champion uses a bow that's set up for me, well, they could cluster it very tightly, but if it's not in the center of the bullseye, if it's over here because of the way the sights are set up, well, it's not a very accurate measure. So we've got to figure out a way to get that accuracy there. So again, if you think about some of the technology we use, we look at bioimpedance, for example, on a weigh scale, looking at percent body fat. So if you're carrying body fat in your upper body, is the accuracy really there from a device that's working through the feet only? And then finally, the validity is the other big question, which I think has a lot to do with how we then interpret the data in not just the high-performance environment, but in the everyday environment. So, you know, again, going back to that archer, if that archer is being tested day in, day out in an indoor environment where there's no wind, there's no light changes, and we get these great scores, we can say, oh, well, you know, this person's going to succeed. But then if the competition is moved outdoors, where now you have to take into account wind changes, for example, is that really a valid measure that they have? So is that the true self? Probably not. And so those are some of the things that we definitely need to think about when we apply these applications. And it also then goes into you know, how we use some of these devices. So for example, if you take something like a VivoFit to track activity, I would never put that on a high-performance athlete if I'm thinking about monitoring their activity level to provide feedback in terms of their training program. But I might put it on them for them to become aware of how much activity they're doing between training sessions. A lot of athletes don't get the recovery that they need to really perform well, and so that might be a device where it is valid to use in that case.
Panelists, any thoughts on that? Depends. Is that what we're saying is the answer?
I don't do a lot of work with high-performance athletes, so I'm going to just kind of defer to your expertise there. But I think when we're talking about kind of just normal, everyday people, a lot of this data is a reflection of a true self, I think, is fair, but maybe not a complete self. So we're measuring kind of very specific things that I think are of importance to these kind of high performance athletes, things that make sense to them, make sense to their coaches, but are maybe very specific and don't represent the whole picture of, you know, I got out of bed today and I went for a run and that I deserve a high five for. So looking at some of those aspects that aren't necessarily captured in the same way at this time.
John?
I think you have both brought up some really good points about the completeness of this data and the value, the real value of quantified self, I think people have seen for a while, is going to come from taking a lot of different data sources and combining them together and looking for insight. So you're not just looking at one time series data stream, you're looking at a lot of time series data streams, and then you're able to analyze across them. So for instance, you know, understanding what the environmental conditions were, was it windy, were you, you know, going into a headwind, does that explain your lower performance today than you had yesterday? And then other factors too that people sometimes talk about bringing in here that I think are really interesting are like social factors, emotional well-being factors. You can understand by looking at your internet activity, for instance, whether you're in touch with friends. Are you calling and emailing your friends? Are you withdrawn? Are you slow today? Are you feeling a little depressed? Are you feeling happy and exuberant? These things all play into it as well, and I think adding more data streams helps to form a more complete picture, but there are always more data streams that could be added, and we'll never have all the data in one system.
Yeah, state of mind is becoming a bigger area of general overall health, right? So, absolutely, right?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, Paul touched a little bit on accuracy. I think that's the biggest challenge. If we look at, there was a research paper recently that showed accuracy of step counters, and, you know, they were all over the map. There were some that were 30, 50, 80% off, and I've seen that in testing as well, that, you know, you get kind of broad ranges there of how far things are off, and if you're looking to get something like power meter testing, then, you know, even just 5% off is unacceptable. On the flip side, for a step counter, 5% isn't that big a deal. You're looking for trends. You're looking to be able to say, you know, you walked 10,000 steps today, that's great, but yesterday you did 1,000 steps. That verifiably sucks, right? You did not walk enough today. And, you know, whether you're 1,000 versus 1,005 doesn't really matter very much. And I think it's kind of understanding the perspective of the device and how accurate it has to truly be.
Yeah, that's an excellent segue into the next question. John, so relative to that, are the measurements accurate enough to determine outcomes, and what is the relationship between actions, goals, and outcomes here?
I think, as Ray has said, the accuracy isn't everything. So in some cases, probably these sensors could be more accurate. In others, they're accurate enough. I think the next step on top of measurement is interpretation. So for you know, a lot of you I've spoken with work with very serious athletes who are able to look at their data and interpret it and relate it to their goals and their plans and adjust their training. For very casual people, you see something similar in the way that, you know, just putting a Fitbit on and counting your steps can make an enormous difference in encouraging you to get a basic level of activity. Going beyond that, I think really good outcomes require really good interpretation of the data and really good consistent coaching. There are, you know, some efforts to do this with you know, fitness for casual athletes. There are also, if you take a step further and think about sort of coaching and interpretation in an even broader sense, there's some really interesting efforts to give you little nudges in your life by reading data and then helping you recognize at inflection points when you ought to be doing something else. There's an interesting desk, you know, in California now everyone has these like sitting standing desks that go up and down, and there's one called Stir that if you've been sitting too long, it starts to kind of bump up and down a little bit to tell you got to stand up, you've been sitting too long. And if you've been standing too long, it starts to kind of nudge down to remind you to take a seat and relax for a little bit. You know, so stuff like that, the recognition of nudges and the importance of giving you feedback to help you improve your wellness is really important. And on the emotional side too, there's some interesting stuff. A startup called Sync that a couple of friends are working on that tries to measure your emotional state and then give you music that would help improve it correspondingly.
Yeah, I think it's also interesting looking at some of the devices and the data they provide, right? So, you know, steps everyone understands, and then there's some things that are legitimate, like potentially interesting for science down the road type metrics. We see some of that in power meters, whatnot, where we don't have answers for that today. We might have answers for that 1 year or 5 years down the road. And then there's kind of those marketing features, right, where things that people put in products just for the sake of checking off a box. And like, if you look at the Withings scale, is probably the perfect example of that. It's a great scale when you stand on it and does body and weight and all that kind of weight, body fat and weight and all that jazz. Great for that. But it also does CO2 measurements. So it sits there behind the scenes and measures CO2 in your house 24 hours a day and plots that. And I look at the app, I'm like, what am I supposed to do with this? Even if it says, like, I'm going to die, what am I going to do? Am I gonna, like, I can't imagine calling my Parisian landlord and saying, fix this. They're going to look at me and, like, maybe next week, right? And so I think it's one of those metrics where you've got to, when you're looking at products, kind of sit back and go, what can the average person actually do with this metric? And how can they use it? How can they use it to improve their life? And CO2 isn't something that really anybody can do anything with other than going, that was interesting. So I think it's kind of important there.
I have to admit, I've got a bit of a love-hate relationship with the whole measurable tech industry, because on the one side, with high-performance athletes, often they'll see a lot of these commercial products and they jump to conclusions that, of course, well, we can apply this immediately and get all the information we want, and they don't really understand the limitations that we know as engineers are actually within those devices. On the flip side, the general public sees what the high-performance athletes are doing and go, oh, I just need that, and you know everything will be great, not understanding that really it's way beyond what they really need in terms of feedback.
I would also argue, I think that the kinds of questions people are asking from their data will make a difference in how accurate it needs to be, whether we're talking about status questions of where am I right now and what does this data say about this instant, this performance, my weight as I'm standing on the scale and looking down at that number, probably matters a lot more than those kind of long-term trends, which, you know, things like step counts probably, mm-hmm. am I being more active overall over time, symptoms or pain, things like that, are my symptoms getting better over time, mm-hmm. over a month, over a year, am I getting healthier overall, probably relies a lot less on the accuracy of the individual metric and more on the kind of big picture, long-term scale.
Yeah. It's a good observation. So into that point, we were talking a little bit about precise measurement and precision in general. Ray, do we need approximate? You were going into, let's investigate that a little bit more. How much do we need approximate or precise measurements?
I think it totally depends on the use case. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, taking again power meters, it needs to be precise and accurate, and every other term we want to throw at it, it needs to be truly there. Otherwise, it's sort of a pointless metric to pace by, which is ultimately the goal in high-performance athletics, is to take that training data and to be able to pace by it when it comes to a race. Mm-hmm. So especially for triathletes, less so important for road racing, where you're having to follow the pack and how that moves along the race. Mm-hmm. But in a triathlon, for example, you're on your own. You're following your own race plan, and if that race plan works out, then great. If it doesn't, that's the best you could probably do on that day. Mm-hmm. On the flip side, you look again at step counters and that kind of stuff, where, like Kaylee mentioned, it's not so much important that it be within 1% accuracy as it is that it's reliable over time, because that's what you're really looking for. You're looking for, are you stepping more or are you stepping less? Is your weight going down? Mm-hmm. One scale actually gives you a smiley face and a frowny face, depending on your trending for your weight. That's what consumers should be looking at. And I think that's actually, like, if you look at weight scales, that's really the benefit of those. It's not, you know, if you take a cheap $10 scale and you stand on it, more than likely that scale is accurate. I did scale testing a few years back, and I bought like 10 different scales, and everything from a $10 Target scale to a $300 Tanita scale, and went into a place that did bod pod testing of athletes, and basically I bought in like, I think with 10 or 15 folks, and just did testing to see how they worked. And every single scale was spot on when it came to weight accuracy, the most important metric. They all nailed it. Body fat, yeah, that was kind of sucky. But weight they got, and that's the piece where trending-wise, mm-hmm. you're looking at that. And so you take a digital scale that records your weight. What that's useful for is because on that $10 scale, you walk in the bathroom, you step on the scale, and you say, it says X. Tomorrow it'll say, hopefully X minus a little bit, but it may not. And then without a digital record of that, you kind of forget about that. And you go, well, it was just yesterday. And you know, a week or a month goes by and it hasn't really changed. With a digital scale, it's uploading that to the internet somewhere and you have a record, you look at it and go, yeah, I really haven't changed my weight over the last year. And it's kind of that reminder. And I think that's probably the biggest benefit of a device like that.
Any other input? Well, let's move on. Haley, when people share their tracked activities, like they do now so often, is this intended to ask for support, to kind of show off or encourage others, or is it just a personal kind of performance selfie? How are people, why are people doing that?
I'm gonna go back, it depends. I think that's gonna be the theme of
today. A lot of depends.
I think there's kind of a lot of different values in that, you know, sharing that data or sharing results, a lot of which I think does have to do with social support. If you know people that are going through similar things, have similar goals, to be able to get that support, get encouragement, kind of build you up when you're struggling, you know, give you something to work for, that motivation, I think is really valuable and I think can be a good motivator for other people. On the other hand, if I do a really good thing and something that I'm proud of, I want to show that off. And I think that's not a phenomenon that's necessarily specific to data necessarily. We do that with other things too, and they're not necessarily mutually exclusive. To be able to say, here's my performance selfie, as you called it, I'm proud of this, and to be able to also say, I need that feedback and that kind of positive reinforcement to keep going and to keep meeting new goals and keep moving forward with some of that. So I don't know that it has to be either or necessarily. They're kind of part of the same cycle.
I think you nailed it. It's all about the audience of what, who you're targeting on that social platform. Like for me, for example, my personal Facebook page, I'll never post a workout to it. I only have ever once posted a workout to my personal Facebook page because there it's a different audience, right? It's family and friends that may not be athletes, that may not go out and, you know, for me to post a, I just rode 100 miles today, what do you do, right? That's, it's tougher. Versus if I'm, you know, on my like DC Rainmaker Twitter or whatever, then that's an audience that is generally fitness focused. It's generally something that's gonna appreciate some element of that, even if it's just a pretty picture that I posted, you know, to the Strava workout file or whatever, they're gonna appreciate that versus my personal friends may be like, it's a little bit bragging there.
Yeah, that's right. John?
I just wanted to add one more thing. That I think because of that audience, there's some sort of expectations too about posts. So if you have a following that knows that you post this kind of stuff and they expect that sort of stuff to be there, then in some cases the absence of a post is actually louder than the post itself. So if I know that people are expecting me to post this picture, expecting me to meet this goal, expecting this of me, then when I don't meet my goal and I don't want to post, I don't want to take that selfie and share that with the world, that can actually be a pretty powerful motivator too.
The internet, generally speaking, has helped people find all sorts of new communities, and I think the fitness communities are really terrific examples of this. If you look at like Strava, for instance, you're able to compete asynchronously against other people who want to compete against you. You know, you're not just the jerk among your friends who always wants to ride in front and get there before everyone else. You have an audience that you can publish to that is concerned with, you know, who comes in first on a particular stretch of road and wants to engage in that. So I think, you know, the in terms of sharing and community, the audience is the major factor.
I'm curious about that. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'm curious about that a little bit more, kind of tying some things in here. We've been hearing use cases. We've been hearing, you know, feedback in the context of this, these kind of social communities. You mentioned sync. Do you see this kind of evolution of more intelligence being built into this data where the kind of interaction and reinforcement, and how would that tie into social channels? Do you understand?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're definitely headed in that direction. I mean, everyone, you know, especially as the hardware business model emerges as kind of selling physical things at low margin and then providing some sort of software service at recurring revenue. The promise of that is that, you know, you buy someone's endpoint, you put it on your body or in your home, and then you get intelligent feedback from the service. So right now everyone is racing to find to build up platforms that could combine a lot of different stuff, that could combine your heart rate monitor, information from your car about where and how you're driving, information from your phone about whether you seem to be happy or sad today, from your social network postings, information from your house about, you know, which rooms you're in, whether there's too much CO2 in your house. We'll figure out a use for that someday, and kind of draw insight from it. So that intelligence, I think, especially for casual consumers who don't have the advice of a really knowledgeable coach, is going to be what pushes this forward in terms of value.
Paul, you were going to say something.
No, I just think we have to be a little bit careful with where all this is going, because for the vast majority of people, they don't really have the background to understand what all those data mean. And even within the sport community, there are definitely subcultures within the different sports as to how they take on board those kinds of data. So in the endurance sports, they tend to get it. They really are into the physiology and understand what the power meters and heart rate monitors and all of that mean. But in other more skill-based sports, it's more about the show. So if you think about some of the snowboarding disciplines, you know, they proclaim to be athletes, but in many ways they're entertainers, and mm-hmm. so the information that and the way they share it is very different.
Mm-hmm. Don't you think that that's true, though, even without the data, that the sports that are kind of performance sports are still performance sports, even if they're not quantified? Mm-hmm. And so if we start bringing in that kind of intelligence aspect, in some ways that can prevent a lot of those kind of, say, injuries that it sounds like you're concerned would happen if people are misinterpreting data or misusing that sort of information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. That's why I said there's a bit of a love-hate relationship, because a lot of it can bring a lot of noise. Trying to go back and analyze all those data and keep on top of what it really means is a huge challenge in the sport industry. Yeah.
I think it's interesting you touched on kind of sport and entertainment there a little bit, where that's something that, you know, we're seeing more and more with that data, right? For example, in the Tour de France or upcoming, so Quark here has a solution, right, where they take that power, heart rate, cadence, speed, et cetera, data, and plot it over a graph. And ultimately, the goal of that data is to drive eyeballs to a site to engage readers into to basically the Ironman World Champions, for example, mm-hmm. coming up next week. So it's to kind of keep them hooked on to that sport and tie them into that. And so it's an area where, you know, that data stream itself isn't something that athlete, you know, after it leaves their bike, truly cares about. Mm-hmm. That's something they're having that moment they're by themselves, but beyond that, it becomes more of an entertainment thing than mm-hmm. it does actually a quantified self thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Great insight. So to that point, Ray, we've been talking about data. In your view, how much data is too much data?
I don't know what you're talking about. I don't understand. Too much data.
Cognitive dissonance. Yeah. You're like...
It depends.
That's the theme for today's panelists. It depends.
Yeah, like it's hard to have, for me to have too much data. But I think, you know, there's a lot of scenarios where there is too much data for a given situation, right? A given person or a given, you know, I went for a ride with Keith. I don't know if he's in here, but Keith from Four Eyes on Monday. And he was joking that he only had two head units and two power meters on his bike at that time. And I'm like, that's not too shabby. And, you know, you get down to the fact of having like one power meter, not even a power meter at all, and having a head unit. And you're like, now you're riding for the sake of riding. Right. And, you know, sometimes that's like my situation is I've got so much data collection going on that you can't really enjoy what you're doing anymore. You can't enjoy the activity because you're trying to make sure that all that data is collected perfectly. So I think it's finding a balance. You know, for some people that are trying to get healthy, then the data is that reminder at the end of the activity, or it could be the definition of the end of the activity, right? There are people that go and set their GPS watch to, you know, burn 500 calories, and whether that takes them 5 miles or 10 miles or whatever it takes them on whatever activity they're doing, once it beeps 500 calories, they stop and they're done. And so it depends on how they're using that data versus a performance athlete that's using it to track or plot data over time to say, I've had a 5% improvement in wattage over the course of a year. And of course, that gets back into accuracy as well.
Do you foresee, Ray, given that, do you foresee, like we were talking a little bit earlier, John, intelligent agents starting to collect that for you and creating a personalized kind of interpretation of data to make it easier for you to enjoy your experience, but telling you what you need to know?
Yeah, I think, you know, we see some of that with kind of automated coaching and stuff like that now, where there are services that will look at that data and try to make coaching suggestions on the fly. Basically the same thing that a human would have done in the mm-hmm. past from a coaching standpoint, and still obviously do today, but to make that broader appeal to people who couldn't afford a coach by itself. The challenge with a lot of that today is that it's kind of repetitive responses. They're not truly that unique. They're kind of a computerized grid, and it spits back something that seems, you know, somewhat relevant to you, but they're not really that relevant. I think the bigger challenge, as John noted, is that the fact that there's so many different data inputs now. And of course, there's been attempts by various companies and organizations to, you know, be partners with other companies and to, you know, take data streams, but I haven't really seen any of those partnerships actually last more than a year or two. It's kind of, people get bored of that and they move on.
I tend to get very nervous when we look at sort of automating all of this. I mean, I think eventually the technology will get there where it gets very good, but to come back to Haley's presentation about people are more than their data and trying to really interpret and then actually make change with those data is a real challenge, and you have to know your athletes intimately to do it well. So I think we have to be very, very careful as to how we progress with that.
I think a really good example of that is like in coaching. Like I've got a coach that, you know, helps me along and whatnot through my seasons, and you know, he could look at a file. Let's say like this week, for example, I flew from Europe on Monday and I've done activities and all sorts of stuff and it's been really busy. So you know, one might look at my heart rate files and say, that heart rate's really low. So a computer might look at that and go, you're underperforming, you should have pushed harder, right? But a coach is smart enough to look at that and go, well, wait a minute, you flew 10 hours on Monday, you're now in the wrong time zone, you've flown back and forth across the Atlantic every single week since August. You're probably tired, your body is probably fatigued, and your fatigue level is why you can't get your heart rate up, not because you're not trying. And that's really that difference between an automated system and, you know, a coach that kind of knows and can provide guidance there. Mm-hmm.
In a way, it sounds like we're kind of in a valley right now where we've started to automate this stuff, the automation isn't quite good enough. If developers are willing to power through and keep pushing this stuff along, we might get to a point where the interpretations are reliable enough to be useful. But you know, while we're crossing the valley, there might be some danger to over relying on computer interpretations.
Just to go back to your question about do we have too much data, I think there are sort of two camps in the world of high performance athletics about let's measure everything and we'll go back and we can sift through it and look for trends and so on, versus no, let's have a really targeted approach. For me, I tend to be in the school of less is more. For the day-to-day interactions with athletes, so we need to get to the point where we can dig through and find out what's actually important. So, for example, currently doing some work with bobsleigh where we're looking at the acceleration of the sled off the start line. And initially, you know, we'll be collecting 200 hertz accelerometer data to try to make sense of what's actually happening as the athletes are hitting the sled. But ultimately, we have to have something that's more simplified for the coaches to use to give instantaneous feedback. So we don't have to collect at that high sample rate. We can have something where we've dialed in the KPIs, and that's what we feed back to them right away. So in that case, less data is definitely a benefit for the coaching staff. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think some of this is kind of similar to a quote from your presentation yesterday about how the problem with computers is that you play with them. And the problem with data, I think, is the same, that you know, it's easy enough to say, I'll just collect all this data and I don't have to use it. But it's also very easy to get addicted to your data, and very easy to, once you have all of this, want to spend a lot of time playing with it or get more data and more data and more data. And the point you're making, I think, is very true of, you know, at what point is, can I just go for a bike ride? Can I just go and enjoy being out in the mountains and enjoy that scenery without feeling kind of that data addiction? Would be kind of interesting, I guess, to explore. All of this data that we have, we don't have to use, but a lot of the times we do anyway.
Mm-hmm. Very good observation. So John, and ladies and gentlemen, we're going to wrap up our Q&A of the panel. It's probably about the next 10 minutes. So please think of your questions, because we're going to have an open Q&A for you with these experts up here to enjoy. So John, on a final question for me, beyond sports and wellness, where else, and we talked a little bit about this before, can we explore a little bit about where else we see this data taking us as far as a multi-dimensional selfie? We talked about well-being. You know, what will this become? Where is this going to head?
I think if you extend your idea of well-being to a variety of factors, maybe your emotional health, your satisfaction with your job, your productivity, the efficiency of your home, your environmental impact, your cultural openness, whether you're traveling and sort of meeting people that you want to meet, you can start to see how a complete picture could theoretically emerge from a lot of the data streams that we're beginning to generate now. So I think that's obviously a long way off, and this is a sort of a casual way of talking about it. We'll just combine all this data and it'll be great. Obviously that's very tricky, but I think that's kind of the direction that it's going, that people will be able to set their own goals for a variety of things and have some intelligent guidance working toward them. So good measurement is important, good interpretation is important, having the right data streams go into it is important. Right now, there's kind of a land rush to put a lot of sensors out and gather a lot of data and send it somewhere, and also a land rush correspondingly in developing platforms that integrate this stuff. But I think it's headed somewhere interesting.
Haley, I'm curious about that question in light of chronic illness, rare disease, all these things, or especially if you think about it right in use cases, because like congenitive heart failure, where that data and tracking it, you know, it's very, very relevant to keeping someone well. What do you think about it in that context?
I think a lot of kind of the challenge in the chronic illness world, and especially the rare disease world, is that the things you need to track change quite regularly. Mm-hmm. And so it isn't something that you're kind of consistently doing over a long period of time. Rare diseases especially, it takes, I think, about 7 years to get a diagnosis, roughly. And even that, one of the people I study was diagnosed with ALS and told he had 2 years to live. 2 years ran out, and they said, actually, you've got this other thing. Surprise. So on the one hand, it's great. Wow. He's alive. He's going to live a long, happy life. But he spent 2 years thinking he was about to die. And so the things that you're tracking, if you think you have one thing, and then you turn out to have another, kind of change a lot. And that can apply, I think, even to just new diagnosis, being undiagnosed, of being really uncertain about what kind of information you need and what kind of data you should be tracking. So what I would love to see, I think, in kind of down the road is some more flexible tools or things that will allow you to kind of play around, try tracking different things, look for relationships between what you're tracking and what you're feeling or what you're noticing in your health. And then stop, give up, say, okay, that didn't work, that wasn't it, now let's try this other thing, without having to kind of commit really to, you know, I am a person who tracks this thing and that is what my life is. So kind of, again, coming back to ways of being able to combine that data, kind of smart ways, maybe be able to recommend, you know, different things to be trying or tracking or things like that, sort of more on the self-experimentation side in some ways, or at least experimenting with different kind of data sources or types of data that you need.
What panelists, what about the new use cases where people are taking this data tracking and merging it with humans to deliver coaching virtually in a variety of different applications? There are a number of these that have launched recently, and when we think about, you know, tracking data and then providing, Paul, what you're mentioning, you know, professionals who are very trained, like you were mentioning, Ray, who are watching this and communicating with people, there are a number of these platforms that have been launched in the last few years. What about those applications in this context?
Yeah, I think it's definitely great. I think one of the challenges there is making sure those coaches, for lack of a better term, know what to do with that data, right? So I think there are sort of metrics out there that you could look at, and a coach would go, well, maybe it means X, and maybe it means Y. You know, I think like left-right balance in cycling is a beautiful example of that, where you know the layperson might look at that and go, we need to have balance be 100% or be 50-50 spot on even, right? But there's actually no scientific evidence that that's a good thing, right? You, in a lot of ways, if athletes try to change their balance, which could be 49-51 or some slight variation thereof, when they do that, they actually lose power because they're focused too much on adding power to one leg, and they actually, you know, subtract a lot more on the other leg. And so that's an area where, you know, it's easy for a coach to assume that it has to be balanced, but that would actually hurt their athlete. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of, I think, training as the new metrics come along to how to deal with that. And you know, look at power meters in general. That's something that's taken really 10 to 15 years for coaching to, widely speaking, catch up to how to train by power. And you know, that same thing's going to have to happen for new metrics you talk about, like muscle oxygenation, for example. And you know, the number of coaches that globally could handle that sort of information is probably only a couple tables worth in this room here. So how do you get that and make coaches understand that on a broad scale across hundreds of countries and you know hundreds of thousands of athletes?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any other comments, Paul?
I think every time we add distance, we probably lose information. And you know, being in the environment to interpret is really, really critical. And if you were talking about the left-right balance, there's a lot of concern, for example, on transferability of strength measures. We look at rowers, for example, and we can measure their power on an ergometer, and we think, great, they've improved, but you put them in a rowing shell and the boat doesn't go any faster. Because there's not the transfer of technique that needs to be there alongside the change in power. You know, in Canada, we've got some great rowers in the eights, which is really a power sport. But as soon as you take those same rowers and put them into a smaller boat where finesse is a little bit more important, they don't do so well. And so, again, having someone there to be able to interpret and make those changes on the spot is really vital.
Any other thoughts? Well, let's open this up to the crowd here. I hope you've had an opportunity to think about some questions. We want to pass the mic out to anybody to ask these folks some.
Do we have a second mic?
Yes. Yes, we do.
Question over here.
You knew I had a question, right, Mike? I'm in the business of data collection. It's high tech.
We need to collect your voice data.
You knew I had a question, right, Mike? I'm in the business of data collection. And there's a couple things you guys were talking about earlier. You can always choose to look at the data you want to look at. You can't look at data you don't have. I would suggest you sample as often as you can, as much as you can, with as many parameters as you can, and then look at it later on. You don't have to look at the data you've collected, right? If you have the choice between precision and accuracy, choose precision, because precision is a measure of how you're doing with respect to yourself. Accuracy is a measure of how you're doing with respect to others. And so if you're trying to improve yourself, which most consumer athletes are trying to do, precision is way better. If you're trying to set a world record, you want to know how you're doing with respect to everybody else. So you need accuracy. Ideally, you get both, right? Your thing was mechanization versus automation. Automated coaches, probably not a good thing right now. But mechanizing the data collection process and the storage of that and the easy retrieval of that, I think, is key. And so anyone who's in the business of doing data collection, mechanize. Make that really good. Make the channels really good. Make it easy to retrieve the data. But you don't have to look at it because you can't interpolate data you don't have, right? Mm-hmm.
So good observation. Thank you. Any comments on that?
I completely agree on, yeah, collecting data is a good thing as long as we're not making it difficult for the consumer to figure out what to do with that data. In other words, if they walk into a room of data and they can't find the right metric because there's so many other metrics, then they're confused. I think, you know, when you get to high performance, like some of the work that you're doing, then it's easier because you're coaching that athlete in kind of a, not so much a true coach sense, but like you're guiding that athlete through which data is important and which data is not important. I think it's tougher when an athlete Like an example is the Basis watch, right? That's a watch that measures a gazillion metrics about your body, from body temperature to just lots and lots of stuff. How to use that data is tricky. Like there's steps, sure, that's there, and that's an obvious thing for consumers, but these other 7 or 8 metrics that they collect about what your skin temperature is doing and things like that, how do you use that? And you know, it's great that it's there, but guiding that athlete's tough.
You have some great points, and I just want to come back to this notion of collect more or less. No question, if we can collect it, it's nice to have it. But in the reality of the day-to-day situation is we have to realize that it also takes time and human resources to do that and actually analyze those data. Typically, when we do this, by the time we get around to doing the analysis, the athlete has already moved on. And so to go back retrospectively and look at that doesn't necessarily help them to improve their performance, or the technology has changed and now those data are less useful. That said, you can then go back and use data mining techniques to start to look for some of those deeper trends that may not be initially visible, and then potentially use that for predictive modeling as well.
Great. Rick?
Yeah, I just have a quick question. We've talked a lot about data today, and the question that comes to my mind, which I'd like to get your perspective and opinion on, is ownership of that data. There's very different models out there of storage systems where the particular company that's doing the storage owns that data, and they can sell that data to third parties for marketing purposes or health-related reasons or whatnot. And then the other model is you own your data, you protect your data only goes somewhere when you allow it. So I just wanted to get your perspective on those two positions.
Great question, Rick. A very controversial question.
I tend to lean more towards the side of my data should belong to me. If it's data about me, I've been collecting it. I'm the person who has the most to lose by that data being exposed. So that should be something I have control over or ownership of. The flip side of that is that because I rely on so many other tools or servers to collect that data, to process that data, I need to be able to trust them to keep it safe, to protect it, to protect me. And that's a lot easier for them to do, or a lot easier for me to trust them, I think, if they also have a stake in it. If they own the data, then they're probably a little bit more motivated. That said, it also becomes easier for them to do things like sell it if they own it, and that kind of concerns me. So it is an interesting challenge for sure. I think I like to see people who the data is about own the data, but I also recognize that it's all kind of part of a big complex ecosystem. So.
Yeah, I think there's actually almost two parts to that question. One is, do you own the data and have access to it? And then do you own the data and can the company sell it, right? So the first piece is that I think it's actually got a lot better in the last year or two, where it used to be companies would pull their data in that you'd collect on some sort of sensor device, and you couldn't actually export it. You could never take it with you, right? It was islanded to that ecosystem until you died or whatever. Like there was no way for you to eventually export that and move it from one company to another company. And I think companies have got a lot better on that. I think people have started to push companies and say, I want to be able to take my data with me. Now, most companies don't make it terribly easy to take your data with you, but at least you can get the data out. The second piece is, can you sell my data? And that's where it gets a little tricky. And I think, as Haley noted, there's an aspect there that a company is a company to make money, right? And that's the end game there. It's not just simply be a not-for-profit institution. So if you're giving data to a company and you're not giving them anything else in return, then there should be some, I guess, awareness there that your data will probably be used for something. But that should be clear. That company should state up front to that consumer that we are taking your data and we may sell it to third parties, or just simply say we are going to sell it to third parties and make it clear. And I think that's fine as long as they're clear about it. If they're nebulous about it and then going ahead and selling it to third parties behind the scenes, then that's a little less ideal.
There's a saying that summarizes what Ray just said, which is that on the internet, if you're not paying for a product, then you are the product. And the service provider is making money by advertising to you, by either selling your data or by using your data to to better target ads to you, which then make money for it. So I'm sort of a pragmatist about this, and you know, I recognize that out of the concern for data privacy and ownership of data, a lot of people have tried to build up services that let you pay for them directly rather than going through an advertising model, and they haven't really taken off with consumers. You know, people have been concerned about the free email services for a while, like Gmail that uses the content of your email to target ads. But you know, how many of your friends have an email address at one of the privacy oriented $10 a month services compared to the number of your friends who have a Gmail account? So commercially, I think there's a lot of pressure to provide free services that are advertising supported, and then sometimes you can get away with a freemium model where you promise that this gives you data ownership or at least better privacy. But I think we've come to a nice medium in a lot of cases where the data is perhaps deep in the terms and conditions owned by the service provider, and it's accessible to advertisers, but also you can export it in some easy, CSV format or something and take it with you. And all of, a variety of service providers have developed import features that let you type in your old credentials on an old service and it sucks in your data from there and puts it in a new service. So as those things develop, I think, data is getting much, much more transportable, even if it's still, being used for advertising and technically owned by someone else.
Yeah, and I've seen a lot of research recently where consumers are more and more trading off. So I'll give you more of my information if I get better user experience. And so that kind of platform experience directly relates to it's a commercial relationship. And people are okay with that as long as they know and as long as they feel that what they're getting in return is worthwhile. That's what I've...
Yeah, and you see that especially in medical data. So medical data is something that's really tightly regulated that you can't do as much with it as you could with, say, your fitness data that you've collected yourself. Or rather, other people can't do it on your behalf. And yet we see a lot of people with really severe health conditions who will just like put their data on the internet, put all of it on a blog, put it on patients like me, sites like that, because they need results so much. And so the threshold of how much data people are willing to give away and how much they expect to get out of it or how badly they want something out of it, I think kind of varies as well. But it'd be interesting to think about, if we think about data as the currency of the internet, so I'm paying with my data for these services, what would it look like then to have the same kind of consumer power and consumer control that we do when we're spending, say, dollars? So if I'm going to Amazon, I can compare prices across a number of different products. I can look at flyers on the come in the newspaper and kind of compare, this is what I'm paying, this is what I'm getting for it. And we don't necessarily have the same kind of control over data as a currency, because it's not always obvious how much of your data you're giving up, what's being done with it, and what you're actually getting for it in return. So.
Yeah. And I'm even seeing where in the fifth era of the social web, there's discussion about communities coming together and bartering with their communal data with brands to make deals, either for bikes or whatever it is you're doing, because of the power of that. So I think these are all very interesting questions from the perspective of what digital is and data is in the realm of commerce and use cases. Great question, Rick. Anyone else have another question? We have about... 5 or 6 minutes, I think, give or take.
Yeah, 10, I'd say.
Yeah, 10 at the most. Anything that could lead to an answer of perhaps or it depends would be good.
I guess I have a question. We've been using the FIT file structure for quite a few years now, and it seems to be a prevalent feature now. I've been answering questions from people that don't even know who we are, but they want to get a manufacturer's ID so their data can be shared with others. As a panel, do you feel that that structure is the correct way to go, and is it being used properly, and are there things that we should do to improve it?
I think a structure is the way to go, something that's agreed upon. And this, and, today, that's largely speaking, it's FIT format. I think all but really one or two companies in the high-performance world, or not high-performance, the advanced GPS-type watch world use that, and that works well, and it provides kind of this common way of getting data across. You know, I think a lot of people that wouldn't be in this room, for example, would say, well, we need a common data format, and they say, give it to me in CSV. And of course, everyone in this room dies a little inside when someone gives them a CSV file, because no two CSV files are the same, right? It's like saying, give me a human. And you're like, well, that's useless. Like, everyone's different. And so when people trade CSV files, that means that they're just trading data with commas in it, right? And that's it. There's no way to define how that data is used or define what that data is for or what it should be for. And I think that is some of the benefit of the FIT file format in today's world, in that those definitions are made up front. They're very clear. And then virtually every app out there can use that data. So I can generally trust that as long as a device manufacturer hasn't screwed it up, I can take that data and put it into Strava or Training Peaks or fill in the blank, any number of other sites out there, and it's just going to work. And that's what consumers ultimately want, the fact that it's just going to work.
Thank you. Good answer. What do you think is in the realm of applications and communities and the different platforms you work with, Ray? What do you think are some of the coolest ones that are taking data and making the user experience better?
It depends. Yeah. It really does depend on the use case, right?
Yeah.
For a competitive cyclist, that's obviously Strava. Right. For someone who's looking to lose weight and burn calories, that's MyFitnessPal. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it's rather unlikely, in fact, that those two groups ever cross each other.
Right. Like
if you talk to a competitive cyclist that's out, you know, sniping segments on Strava, and you tell them ask them what's MyFitnessPal, they'll look at you like, and the same is true if you ask the same people for MyFitnessPal. So it really goes to who the audience is and who's the use case for that particular data set. And I'm sure there's obviously many other examples out there if I were to look at other sports as well. But it really comes down to what the sport is, what's the athlete is, what's the goal, what's all that kind of stuff.
Hmm. That's a good answer.
Do you feel, Ray, that there's a mixture or a sweet spot that isn't being attained now that you would suggest if somebody was working on that would be a good thing?
Mm-hmm. Good question.
I think it's hard to boil the ocean. I think trying to boil the ocean never really works. And I think if you try to be everything to everyone, you end up with bland nothingness, right? And so I think you wanna target something and be really good at that. And of course, companies buy things to add, you know, new features to the products. They could buy another company. They could do whatever to expand their user base and expand what they're targeting. But I think it's better to be really good at something to be so-so at everything.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think if you look at some of the acquisitions by MapMyFitness, for example, mm-hmm. right? Those acquisitions aren't targeted at technology. Those are targeted purely at buying people. Yeah. They're targeted at buying users to then, you know, monetize their data and everything else, just like we talked about a couple minutes ago. Whereas other acquisitions, like some of the stuff that Strava would do, isn't about buying people. It's about buying a functionality, buying a very specific thing they wanted to add as a feature and calling it done. So they're a little bit different.
Yeah, good feedback. Any other questions from the crowd? Well, I want to thank everyone. Oh, we got one. Good. One last one.
So I've been trying to formulate this for about half an hour, this question, and I think I've got it. I've been to 8 symposiums now, all of them. Love this. The panel is definitely the best part. Thank you, guys. We always look for what's next as designers. We've certainly seen the evolution of data and how much data we have now. A couple of things that I was noting on my list of things to do out of this as far as what's next is we've talked a bit about what I think might start us down the path of looking at artificial intelligence in interpreting data. And another thing I thought about was, what about using our data to start predicting or establishing a catalyst for people that aren't collecting data? If we were to pick between artificial intelligence or figuring out how to get more people involved in data collection, what would be the better route to take for our efforts, in your opinion?
Talk about bowling the ocean. That's
so,
a big one.
Yeah. It happens when I sit in the middle next to the mic. I think, you know, it's interesting you look at those two, they're obviously two different groups of people you're targeting. With the second one where you're trying to get more data collected, I think if you're providing a carrot with that, then it becomes really interesting. So for example, insurance companies that are basically enticing employees to wear activity trackers and in turn, they get something out of that, right? It's typically that if they hit goals of certain number of steps, then they could get points, and those points can be used for vacations or TVs or whatever the case is. I think that's probably a better global benefit than trying to automate something at the high end of things. I think, you know, being able to say, we're going to try to get a company that may have, you know, 50% obesity rate and lower that to 42% is definitely a worthy goal versus trying to automate that little piece that may be only applicable to a couple percent.
Yeah, but it's a really good question, and I think more data leads to better artificial intelligence. So if you in terms of like what to approach first, my immediate instinct would be more data, and data is really the content of these services, and that's the differentiator. That's the special thing that you can provide. I think focusing on that, some of the artificial intelligence needed is very sophisticated. Some of it is sophisticated, is not that sophisticated to implement once you have a lot of data.
Right.
There was this paper that a couple of researchers at Google published a few years ago about how, if you have enough data, the algorithms don't matter.
Right.
Like you can, you need really, really sophisticated algorithms to draw conclusions from poor data, but if the data is huge and pretty high quality, then interpreting it is a fairly straightforward thing.
That's exactly right. I think people largely underestimate where AI is. I think there are many use cases right now being deployed. MRIs, for one example. The best radiologist in the world in the coming months will not be able to beat what's going on with scanning via Watson. This is real, and it proves the point. The Turing test was passed just in the last, 18 months, where people couldn't discern between an AI and a human. This is very real, and I agree with you that it's directly related to the quantities of data and then being able to apply those use cases. And you're going to see this, I think, become very relevant in disease management and in medicine, and it'll extend out to other realms as long as there's enough information, right? Anything else? Great question, by the way. Well, thank you all. Let's give a round of applause to our esteemed panel, please. Thank you for being here. Great job.